What's up, folks?
Woo!
Y'all ready to get started?
Go.
Brad said something this morning. I want to say something first before I get started. Out of all the business partners I've ever had in my life, I want to give credit to a person that is truly, some people talk a good game, but some people are actually very good business partners. And I want you to give a hand because Brad Lee is one of my best business partners I've ever had in my life, man. So thank you for this. He will do whatever you want, whenever you want, however you want. So anything that you need from him, please just got to ask him, man.
Aww.
Come on. Now, here's a question I have for you. Brad used the word decision. Anybody know what the word decide means? The word decide means to kill off. You're killing something off. The word decision means to cut away. You are deciding to make a decision to go pro. At some point in everyone's life, we make a decision to leave our amateur desires behind, and we make a decision to go pro. And that's really why you're here, right or wrong?
Right.
To get real, you're making a decision to go pro. I spent a decade of my life as a championship women's basketball coach, and as I was listening to Brad talk about this concept, is we trained every day. We had role play every day. We had simulation every day. And if you didn't get it right, you trained more. You stayed after practice. You worked harder. You didn't just go home. You kept going. You kept working. So moms and dads would drop their daughters off to me at 14 years old because I was a high school basketball coach. And moms and dads would drop their daughters off to me, and they all said the same thing. Coach, my daughter's got a lot of what? What do you think they said?
Potential.
Every now and then they said issues. Right about that. Issues. Now they say she got a lot of potential. Potential is an idea of kinetic energy that is stored, listen to the words I'm using, until activated. It is an idea of kinetic energy that we will be better today than we were yesterday. We will be better tomorrow than we are today. That we will never stop getting better. And those moms and dads say, man, my daughter's got a lot of potential. How many of you have kids? Raise your hand if you got kids. I've got a 9-year-old and a 10-month-old. And when you look at those children, you say they have a lot of potential, right? And so I would say thank you for bringing your daughter to the Greatness Factory. Because here at the Greatness Factory, we are going to manufacture her greatness in four parts of her nature. Body, that represents skill. And I'm going to show you this. If you're training people, here's what I want you to understand. The body represents skill. How many of you think you would make more money if you had better skills? Money does not buy you freedom. Skills buys you freedom. Doesn't matter if you're generating 3,000 leads every 90 days if you can't convert those leads. The word conversion means to take nothing and turn it into something. The word close means to bring two things together, to bring something to an end. So how many of you believe skills buys you freedom? Yeah. So I would say, hey, we're going to grow your daughter in the body. That's skill. In the mind, that's knowledge. In the heart, that's passion, or we're going to call that Pray Drive today, which is a book I'm writing right now. And in the spirit, that's confidence. If you are training people, you need to be training them in four parts of their nature. Knowledge, skill, desire, and confidence. And then I would say to the parents, but I got a question for you. You're telling me that your daughter has a lot of potential. Is that what you're telling me? They say, oh yeah, coach, she just needs something. What do you think they said she needed? Every now and then said a good whipping. That's what she needs, a good whipping. What she needs is what?
Direction.
What else? Come on, folks. Participate with me.
Focus.
Coaching.
Leadership.
Discipline. Structure.
Mentorship.
Accountability. Mentorship. Then they would say all she needs is a good coach. All she needs is a good coach. And I'd say, if you're telling me your daughter has potential, let me ask you a question. And you may or may not like this question, but I got to ask you, man. Is your daughter watching you reach your potential? And then they're like, oh, coach. Like, I didn't know you were going to be coaching me, right? And I'm like, I will run your little ass around the parking lot just like I run theirs. Now, here's my point. When we think about something, let me try that one. When we think about something, when we think about growing people, can you see where you need to grow people in four parts of the nature? Yes or no?
Yes.
So 18, 19, 20, 21, I'm coaching. I was fortunate to become the youngest head coach in the state of Tennessee. So now I'm coaching at the second largest high school in Tennessee. and I'm coaching these kids, and around 18 years old, I had a discovery. I was exposed to something. One of my coaches said, if you don't read another book this year, pick up a copy of The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey. 18 years old, I go down, I pick up a copy of The 7 Habits. I read The 7 Habits, and I couldn't understand it. How many of you read The 7 Habits? It's incredibly complicated. I thought a paradigm was a paradigma. I'm like, what is he talking about, right? He's talking about personality ethic and character ethic and these 7 habits of very successful people. And I'm like, you know what? I'm going to teach every kid these 7 habits. Every player that comes to play for me, imagine your daughter 14 years old. Every day I'm going to teach her the 7 habits of highly effective people. I'm going to teach her the principles of good to great. I'm going to teach her the 5 dysfunctions of teams. I'm going to teach her the 5 disciplines of a learning organization. And I would take these kids that had some knowledge, sound like your employees, some skill, some desire, and some confidence. They would spend 5.5 hours a day with me for 4 years, and we would turn them into little stone cold killing machines. How many of you think you could take your employees with some knowledge and some skill and some desire and some confidence and manufacture some greatness in those people? Yes or no?
Yes.
Jefferson, this is what you're doing every single day, taking your people. Brad said training's not something you did, it's something you
do.
Sports teams don't train every now and then. Military doesn't train every now and then. World-class athletes don't train every now and then. So why do business people train every now and then? Right or wrong? So when you're thinking about this, so we're starting to teach everybody these whole things, and we start to win games. And when I say we start to win games, we start to win a lot of games. So people were constantly asking me, man, what are you doing with those kids? And I said, man, we're growing the body, the mind, the heart, the spirit. We're training every day. They spend 5.5 hours with me every day. I'm coaching all 4 parts of their nature. This is why we're winning, man, is we're training. And so at 25 years old, I sit down and I did one of the best things I ever did, was wrote my first book. A little book I wrote called Changing Lives Through Coaching, because I believe a good coach can change your life. How many of you have ever had a good coach in your life? Okay. How many of you think who's coaching you matters? You pay for your kids to have coaches. My daughter's got a horse riding coach. She's got a gymnastics coach. She's got a basketball coach. And then we get to be an adult and say, man, we don't need coaches anymore. We got it all figured out. But what happens is that actually suppresses our prey drive. Is that we get comfortable, complacent, static, stuck, bored, in a rut, because we don't have that tension. We don't have that coach. We don't have that fire. So at 25 years old, I wrote a book for coaches, but guess what? Coaches wouldn't buy it. They're like, man, who is this kid? He's only 25 years old. He hadn't won a championship yet. And somehow that book got in the hands of business people. And business people began to call me, and they say, man, will you come down and speak to and motivate our people? The word motivate means to move. The word inspire means to breathe life into. And so I said, man, would you come over and speak to our people for a few minutes? And a manager at Dell Computers, which was one of the biggest companies in the world, he called me one day and said, will you come speak to our people? And I said, sure, but I got to fit it in tight, man. I'm coaching these kids. I'm trying to win championships. I'm totally focused on winning championships. And I love these kids. And I went over and I spoke for 1 hour. At the end, he said, man, we loved it. Will you come back and train our people and coach our people? I said, I'm sorry, man. I'm trying to win games. I love these kids. I haven't won a championship yet. I'm working 80 hours a week every week. I'm trying to build something special here, man. Thank you for buying my book. Thank you for bringing me down to speak, but I'm not interested in staying and speaking to your people. I got to get back to these kids. And we kind of got in an argument. He's like, are you kidding me? He's like, man, we're Dell Computers. We're one of the biggest companies in the world. You don't want to come back and train our people? And he finally said, okay, fair enough. And he reached in his pocket. And he pulled out a check. He said, here's your check for coaching our people for 1 hour. And I said, you going to pay me to coach your people? He said, yeah, man. We're one of the biggest companies in the world. And I opened up that check, and it was more in 1 hour than I made in 1 month. And I thought about it for a second, and I said, surely somebody else will come along and love those kids as much as I do. You know what I'm saying? Like, I love them kids. But somebody come along and love them kids as much as I do. True story is I actually stayed 6 more years until I built a national powerhouse, and that's why you see this big gaudy ring on my right hand, is it took me a decade to build a national powerhouse at a place that would go on to win 7 of 9 championships. And thank you very much. And there's a lot of lessons to be learned in there. 10 years, long obedience in the same direction, 10,000 hours of practice. Right? And along the way, I'm writing book 1 and book 2 and book 3 and book 4. And what I'm really studying is what I want to talk to you about today, which is how to activate a drive inside of a person. How many of you have talented people on your team, and you see that potential of them, but you cannot figure out how to flip that switch? How many of you have that? Some of you may say, that's me. You're talking to me, Coach Burke. Is that you have talent. You have potential. You've been told your whole life you could do something big. But for some reason, you can't flip the switch. And that is the title of my 17th book that I'm writing right now that'll be out in all the bookstores and airports in February of 2022 about how to activate the prey drive in a person. I'm sitting at a boot camp workshop with my wife. It's a direct selling workshop for a company called Juice Plus. And I'm there to hear a guy talk about how he activates things in people. And he's a former Vietnam veteran. And he was in the War Dog Division of the Vietnam War. And the War Dog Division of the Vietnam War was a division that actually went out ahead of the infantry to make sure that there were no bombs or booby traps or ambushes. Imagine you waking up every morning in a jungle with just you, and he had an animal, and the animal was a dog. Imagine you, any day you think you got it tough, any day you think your job is hard, any day you think this is rough, imagine waking up in the middle of a jungle with just you and an animal, and that's it. Hoping that you didn't die that day. Hoping that you don't step on a bomb. Hoping that you don't step into an ambush. Imagine the psychology of you telling yourself every day, I'm not dying today, man. And he kept talking about this dog having a prey drive. The dog had a prey drive. And I'm sitting there thinking, prey drive? Prey drive. What is this prey drive? And I begin to look at this, and here's what I begin to find out. I begin to think about this. I'm pointing this somewhere back there. I don't know if it's working, but I'm pointing.
Is it on?
Okay, I hope it's on. Point toward the screen. Nope, they told me to point it back there. Okay, point it. What about just point at you? Can you figure it out? Okay, it's a good thing I'm writing this book and I know what I'm talking about. Fair enough? Now, here's the deal. Kept talking about the dog having a prey drive. So here's what I do. I look at the definition of prey drive in the dictionary. Here's what it says. An animal's ability to stalk, capture, and kill prey. Does that sound like a good salesperson? Yes or no? Where's Albert at? Albert, you back there? I think I saw you come in.
Right here.
Where you at, big guy? Hey, let me ask you a question. Does that sound like a good salesperson?
Right here.
Where's he at? There you go. Does that sound like a good salesperson you'd like to have? Ability to stalk, capture, kill prey.
Sounds perfect.
Because here's the deal. Albert's a stone cold killing machine. So I'm sitting there and I'm thinking, guys, and I'm thinking, and I'm thinking, and I'm thinking, and I tell my wife, here's a revelation I had. Humans have a prey drive, but it has not been activated. It is latent. It is undeveloped. It has gone dormant. It is dead. Humans have a prey drive. And then I tell my wife, this is what I've been doing since I was 15 years old, is I have been activating this drive in people. First as a women's basketball coach, and now in people all over the world, some of the top people in the world, activating that drive. How many of you believe that you have another gear that you haven't found yet? Raise your hand. So I want to put these into categories. So prey drive, here's my definition of prey drive. Prey drive is an instinctual ability to see something with the eyes or in the mind. So I can see it optically, I can see it, I see it, I'm stalking it. I can see something with my eyes or in the mind, and I have the persistence and the intensity to pursue it. Everybody see that? How many of you see something in your mind, but you don't have the persistence and intensity to pursue it? See, I see it. You go there in the mind before you go there in the body. All things are created twice, first mentally, then physically. I see it in the mind before I go there. So let me ask a question. How many of you believe in your own future? Raise your hand if you believe in your future. I've never had a person around the country tell me they didn't believe in their future. Well, here's a question that seems like a trick question, but it's not. Where does your future live? See, a lot of people tell me it lives in here. No, it actually lives in your imagination. I can't see your future. The only person who can see your future is who?
You.
You can blame your wife. You can blame your kids. You can blame Your parents? You can blame whoever you want for not manifesting that future, but the only person who can see that future is you. You go there in the mind before you go there in the body. All things are created twice, first mentally, then physically. I had to see myself as a championship coach before I became a championship coach. Everybody see that? Now, I want to put prey drive in a category. Three categories, and I want you thinking where you fall off the wagon. Number one, the prey drive has to be activated. And I'm going to show you how to activate it every single day. Number two, there must be a persistence to the prey drive. And I want you to write this down. Long obedience in the same direction. 10 years. Long obedience. Why do they say people have a breakthrough at 10 years? 10,000 hours of practice. But here's what they don't tell you. When Gladwell wrote that book and said people have a breakthrough at 10,000 hours, here's what he found. And this is what people don't talk about. You can do something for 10 years and still suck at it. Yes or no? How many of you have been playing golf for 10 years but you still suck at golf? You know why? Because what they don't tell you, it's not 10 years of practice doing something. It's 10 years with the coach, with correction. It is not just 10 years of doing something. This is why people don't have breakthroughs. 10 years with a coach, with correction, with feedback, right? So persistence is long obedience in the same direction. If I say you need to be prospecting every day you need to prospect. Every day you need to go 7 to 15 touches in your follow-up. Every day you need to try to engage with your current client base. Every day you need to be planning something in the future. Every day. How many people do it some days, but they don't do it what? Every day. I was doing an event a few weeks ago with Dana Cavalia, and he was the performance coach of the New York Yankees when they won a World Series. And I said, did A-Rod miss practice? Did Jeter miss practice? Nope. They're there every day. At the same time, every day, within just a few minutes of each other. I said, who missed practice? He said, all the amateurs. Listen to what I'm about to tell you. Amateurs listen to their feelings. Professionals do not listen to their feelings. Amateurs listen to their feelings. Persistence is I show up every day when I don't feel like it. I fight through every day. You think Journey wants to sing Don't Stop Believing Again? But that's what you pay to go see when you go see them, right or wrong. The great people show up every single day and they work the muscle. So the second piece of prey drive is persistence. Third piece of prey drive is intensity. And this is really where people fall off the wagon. Intensity is I see it and I pursue it. Many years ago, I wrote a book called Zebras and Cheetahs. And I studied cheetahs to write that book. And here's what I figured out. Cheetahs have a closing ratio of 60%. When a cheetah wakes up in the morning, it stalks it, it pursues it, it kills it. Right? And if it doesn't kill its prey in a concentrated period of time, it actually has to calm its own self down, or it will actually kill its own self by how hard the cheetah attacks the prey. So if it doesn't kill the prey in a concentrated period with an intensity, the cheetah actually has to back up. That's why you see a cheetah go and sit under, right? And go sit under a tree because it's calming itself down. Now, very seldom do I see people that I say, man, you better slow down, you're going to kill yourself. Most of the time, what are we telling people? You don't have an intensity. You don't pursue with an intensity. You move at a moderate pace. You need to push harder. You need to create more action. You need to take more steps. So I want you to take a second right now, and I want you to tell the person beside you, out of the three areas of prey drive, activation, persistence, and intensity, where do you fall off the wagon when it comes to your instinct to see something and pursue it? Where do you personally think you need the most help? Take a minute right now and tell that person beside you. There we go. I got to wake some folks up. Is it okay if I walk out here?
Yes.
I don't want to scare anybody. Now, when you're thinking about where you fall off the wagon, right? Activation, prey drive has to be activated. How often does it have to be activated? Every day. I'm going to show you the formula I use to activate my drive by 8 a.m. every morning. In the body, in the mind, in the heart, and in the spirit, all four parts of my nature. Right? I woke up one morning, I said, man, I don't feel like doing this today. I told my wife, right? Man, I just don't feel like motivating these people. Man, I can't believe I got to motivate these people. My wife rolled over at 5:30 in the morning, she said, then watch one of your videos. I'm like, all right, I see how this is going to be. Now, here's the good news. I did watch one of my videos, and guess what happened? I motivated my damn self. Because when I'm doing videos, I ain't doing them for you. Guess who I'm doing them for?
Myself.
Me. I do a video every single morning. I never feel like it. Amateurs listen to what? Their feelings. Professionals do not listen to their feelings. Every morning I do a video, I'm doing it for me, I'm not doing it for you. I'm telling my brain this is what's about to happen. I'm kickstarting my pre-drive to get going every single day. So let's just have a show of hands, let's look at the three areas. And Jefferson, Jefferson's one of my clients up here in a high level with me called the Tycoon Package. And so he travels around the world with me, and we do masterminds and all that kind of cool stuff. When you're thinking about where your people fall off the wagon, Jefferson, where is it? Is it activation? Is it persistence? Is it intensity?
I think it's probably a little bit of the persistence and intensity.
So when you think about activation, very few people say activation. Now let me ask you a question. Most people say persistence or intensity. The greatest suppressor of your prey drive, as I'm writing this book, this is the 17th book I've written, folks. As I'm reading stuff and I'm studying all the big time people, what activated Steve Jobs' prey drive? What activated Elon Musk's prey drive? What activates Brad Lee's prey drive? What activates the top people's prey drive? Something. Almost every time it was exposure to something. Elon Musk read comic books. And in the comic books, there's always a superhero that tries to save the world. Everybody see that? So when you're thinking about your prey drive, what I want you thinking is your prey drive can be activated by watching something. Your prey drive can be activated by listening to something. Your prey drive can be activated by watching a video in the morning. So most people don't fall off there. Now the question becomes, why do we fall off the wagon when you're thinking about this? Why do we have satisfied needs? So guess what I did? I studied the top 20 motivational theories to write this book. Every motivational theory does the same thing. When I write a book, I take a concept, Josh, and I deconstruct that concept. And I deconstruct it down to its simple elements, because that's what a good coach does. They take something complicated and they make it simple. So I took the top 20 motivational theories, I deconstruct those, and then I codify that concept. Codification is where I break it down where I can share it and duplicate it with other people, where it can be multiplied over and over and over. That's what I've done with this prey drive concept. So I'm reading every motivational theory, and every motivational theory says the same things. We move toward things we want. When we're hungry, we move toward food. When we're thirsty, we move toward water. When we're lonely, we move toward people. What happens when we have everything we want? See, here's what happens. That actually suppresses your prey drive. See, we're good. We got a good house. We got a good car. We got a good family. We got a good life. So we become lazy. Another way to say it is complacent. Complacency is a gradual settling to a place of mediocrity. Anybody send their kids off to school in the morning, the last thing they say before they get in the car is say, look, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go gradually settle to a place of mediocrity. Anybody tell their kids that?
No.
But how many adults do it every single day? Go back to the question I asked the mom and dad. Is your kids watching you reach your potential? Is your kids watching you dream? Are your kids watching you strive? Are your kids watching you push? Are your kids watching you go to the next level? Because the best thing I can do for my two kids is for them to say, my dad got up every day and went and got it, man. Every day my dad went out and got it. He never became complacent. See, as a basketball coach, I can win on Tuesday night, get lazy, get complacent, get beat on Friday night. Friday night never cared about Tuesday night. So at 31 years old, I retired from athletic coaching and I start coaching all these big companies. Companies were bringing me in to drive $1 billion or $2 billion or $3 billion. They say, man, we're at $2 billion and we're trying to get to $5 billion. Here's the people. Take these people and make them better. And here's what I couldn't figure out. Nobody trained. Nobody had persistence. Nobody had intensity. And I come from an athletic world and I'm like, what are these people doing? They're not doing anything. And with just some coaching and some training, Brad says it like this, good content, role play, repetition, and testing. If we just added good content, if we just added training, if we just added role play, if we just added testing, how much better? We could take average people and make them a lot better, yes or no? With a good coach, people always perform at a higher level. So I'm watching these people, and then I start to say, what suppresses the prey drive? Well, good is the enemy of great here. I told my wife we're going to live an extraordinary life, but the extra's got to come from somewhere. Now, why should you be interested in this? Why should you be interested in your potential? And I'm going to give you my best story for this. Many years ago, I was exposed to Maslow's hierarchy of needs somewhere in elementary school. I went to college for 9 years to pursue 3 degrees. Not once did they ask me about my potential. Not once did they tell me how to activate my prey drive. Not once did they help me find my voice. Not one time. Almost 400 hours of college credit. not one class on how to find this drive inside of me and take this drive and do something big. But if you study Maslow's hierarchy of needs, he basically says you can't self-actualize, and self-actualization is where you reach your deepest human potential. How many of you in your lifetime, how many people have you been around that you think have actually reached their deepest human potential? That you would say are totally self-actualized people? I bet in your lifetime it's been less than five people. Would you agree?
Yeah.
When you're around them, it's like, man, this dude is playing at such a freakish level, I can't even get my mind around it. I can't even get my mind around where this dude is playing. That is self-actualization. That means they are actualizing their deepest human potential in the body, in the mind, in the heart, and in the spirit. And what happens is it's easy to sell something when you're self-actualizing because so many people are attracted to what you're doing. You're a person of advancement. You give off the impression of increase. How many of you, by coming to Las Vegas and walking here, already thought bigger after the first day? Raise your hand. Did Brad Lee give off the impression of increase, yes or no? I remember when I first started building my coaching business, I was on a podcast one night, and I said, man, I was kind of, you know, bragging, and I'm like, man, I'm doing $250,000 a month. Man, I'm doing $250,000 a month. I was so excited I was doing $250,000 a month, right? I'm in my coaching business, and Brad Lee called me afterward, and he said, bro, he's like, man, you got to quit saying that. He said, it's embarrassing. He said, a dude like you with the talent you got ought to be doing $2.5 million a month. You shouldn't be talking about doing $250,000 a month. Now I'm trying to figure out how to do $250,000 in an hour. Is that possible, yes or no?
Yes.
It is possible. When I was a high school basketball coach, I made $25,000 a year. How do you make $25,000 an hour? Because there are people doing it, yes or no?
Yes.
There are people doing it. With the kind of scale and ability. Okay, I'm working on a coaching deal right now, 40,000 people. Even if we charge $97 a person, what's the numbers add up to on that? How much? $3.6 million. Just at $97. $97 for a year's worth of coaching for 40,000 people. It's $3.6 million. That's a good deal for them. It's a win for them. It's a win for me. Would you agree?
Yes.
How do you train 40,000 people at one time? With the Lightspeed system. That's how you do it. Where they can be trained every single day. Now, what company wouldn't turn down to get training for a year for $97? But that's generate. Go ahead, Brad.
Dumb ones.
That's right. Not the smart ones, the dumb ones. And here's what I'm telling you. If I can do it, you can do it, folks. Because I was coaching 14-year-old kids and 15-year-old kids for a decade of my life until I started thinking bigger. So when you think about this suppression of prey drive, we should be interested in our potential. And let me tell you why. There's been two times in my life that I've been asked to speak at two funerals. And they called me and they said, look, we don't have anybody to speak at this funeral. They don't have a pastor. They don't have anybody who can really eulogize them appropriately. We know you speak for a living. We know you don't know these people, but would you mind giving the eulogy at their funeral? I said, no, I'll be happy to. But I got some questions I have to ask. I need a family member. I need a friend. I need a coworker. They gave me the numbers of these people. I said, my job is to give them a proper eulogy. They lived on planet Earth for 84 years, and I'm going to stand up at the funeral and say something about them. But I got a question for you. What kind of dreams did they have? They said, well, they didn't have any dreams. How many people did they help on planet Earth? Well, they really didn't help a lot of people. What kind of big goals did they pursue? Well, they didn't really pursue any goals. And I kept hearing this over and over. They were just a good person. Do you know what it's like to stand up and give the eulogy at a funeral when you don't have anything to say? Except they lived 84 years, and about 84 years, they were just a good person. Less than 30 people showed up for the funeral. And I stood up there, and I literally had nothing to say. And I told myself that day, man, I ain't living a life. At the end of my life, every how many years the good Lord gives me, I want to do so many things in my life that they got to pick the top three. Yes or no? This dude wrote books, coached kids, helped millions of people, wrote, you know, created programs. But I don't want you to get up there. Now, this is where the intensity of the prey drive comes in. Because if you sense something for me, it is an intensity. And the intensity is I have a long way to go and a short time to get there. I've got such big goals that I have no margin for messing around. I have no margin for drama. I have no margin for low energy. I have no margin for getting involved in other people's problems. I have no margin for you talking small. What I have margin for is to focus. So I used to, when I come in, I would put a number on my whiteboard, and it started at 18,000. And I would ask my team, what do you think this number means? What does the 18,000 mean? They say, is it a revenue number? They kept trying to guess, and I said, no. I said, if I live to be 84 years old, that's how many days I got left on planet Earth. And every day that number went down. And when you start thinking about life like that, folks, you watch that number go down every day. You start creating an intensity about you. You've got big goals. Some of you are not thinking big enough, just like I wasn't until I met Brad. I was still thinking small. Brad has helped me to expand my think, to say, you're one of the most talented dudes in the world. You need to be doing more. You need to be thinking bigger. You need to be playing on bigger stages. You need to be in front of more people. You don't need more money, folks. You need more people. The people have the money. But they don't give you the money unless you solve a problem for them. Money changes hands when problems are solved. The bigger the problem, the more money people pay to solve that problem. So when I'm looking at the company that I've said, hey, 40,000 people, what's the biggest problem they have? Man, they got confidence problems. They got closing problems. They got conversion problems. They got follow-up problems. If I could solve that problem for your company at $97 a person, and we generate $3.6 million by solving a simple problem, how much more money will they make? See, here's what I figured out. If I can help a company make $20 million more dollars, or $30 million, or $40 million, or $1 billion more, they don't mind giving me $1 million of it. Would you agree? See, I used to think bluegill. Let's go out and let's fish for little bluegills, one little client at a time. Then I started thinking blue marlins. How do we solve big, juicy problems? Because that's where the money is, right? But prey drive is attached to your confidence. If you don't have confidence, you won't pursue the blue marlins. You cannot control the response. You can only control the stimulus. All you can control is the ask. Okay, so I'm going to give you some activators of prey drive to figure out which is your primary activator. Would that be valuable for you? Yes or no?
Yes.
Because if you don't know what activates your prey drive, so let's start by how to activate it every single day. Every morning I activate my prey drive by 8 a.m. and I feed all four parts of my nature. Number one, I wake up every morning. I listen to a song called It's a Great Day to Be Alive. Every morning. Then I watch a 20-minute sermon because I'm a faith-based person. So for 20 minutes, I watch one of my favorite pastors. That feeds my spirit. I then spend 20 to 30 minutes with my two kids and my wife. That feeds my heart. I then box. Boxing is my favorite form of exercise, so I box for 20 or 30 minutes. That feeds my body. I then listen to something on business while I'm getting ready, fixing my hair, getting ready to start the day. You know what I'm talking about? Okay? I then listen to something on business. Everybody have somebody that they like to listen to on business, yes or no?
Yes.
I'd love for you to listen to me. I'm on YouTube. I'm on Lightspeed. I'm on podcast. Right? Every morning, coaching your life. Every single morning, giving you the coaching, activating your prey drive. By 8 a.m., my prey drive is activated. Do I always wake up with it activated?
No.
Of course not. I wake up just like
you do.
Tired, frustrated, unmotivated, ready. I got to do something to flip the switch in me. Body, mind, heart, spirit. I meet with my team at 8:45. For those leaders in the room, the purpose of that meeting is one thing, guys. You got one purpose of your morning meeting. It is not to teach them everything you know. It is to activate their prey drive. See, most people think when I get in this morning meeting, I got 30 minutes. Man, I'm going to teach them everything I know in 30 minutes. Nope. You're not going to teach them everything you know. Your number one purpose of that morning meeting is to activate that drive. To get your troops excited to go into battle today, man, because they got beat up yesterday. They lost some a little bit yesterday. Their confidence is a little bit low. So every morning by 8 a.m., I activate that prey drive. Now, what activates your drive? Over 28 years of experience, I have found five activators. Now, I'm going to say something that's going to shock you, and I know Brad doesn't mind because he's as controversial as I am. Chapter 3 of my book is called Screw Your Why. Not screw your wife. Screw your why. You say, what? I thought everybody had to find their why to do something big in the world. That's what we've been told, yes or no?
Yes.
What if I told you the top five people I'm coaching right now have no idea what their why is? They just have something that you can't put in them and you can't take it out of them. What if I told you after 28 years of coaching people that I don't actually think you find your purpose and then do something big? I actually believe your purpose finds you when you are pursuing something. Can I get an amen on that?
Amen.
See, everybody in the world is like, man, I haven't found my why. I haven't found my purpose. And I was out there one day speaking somewhere, and I said, you know, I'm out here doing this for my kids and my wife. And I went home that night, and my wife said, I saw that video of you speaking. She said, I heard you saying that you were out here working this hard and doing what you do for us. You know what she said? Quit lying. She said, you ain't doing this for us. She said, we benefit from it. We live in nicer houses. Our kids go to better schools. But you don't wake up and do what you do every day for us. You do it for you. And she said, and that's okay. See, that the PC thing to say is, man, I get up every day and I do this for my kids. I do it for my wife. I can't tell you how many people don't do something big because they don't feel like they found their why. I didn't know I wanted to coach until I started coaching. I didn't know I wanted to write books until I started writing books. I didn't know I wanted to coach adults until I started coaching adults, folks. I didn't sit and find my purpose and then do something big. I actually just took an action. When in doubt, take an action. And guess what? When you take enough action, many times your purpose will flat out find you. And when it does, like, this is what I'm supposed to be doing. When you think about your prey drive, I want you to put it into these buckets. Number one, activator prey drive is fear. Fear is a primary activator of prey drive. Fear, I want to change your perspective of fear. Fear is your friend. See, if you look up Merriam-Webster's dictionary, and you look up the word fear, it says fear is an unpleasant emotion created by a belief that something or someone could harm me in the future. That's what fear is. It's an emotion created by a belief that something's going to harm me in the future. Now, let me ask you a question. Who died and made Merriam-Webster queen? Could you change the definition of fear? Yes or no? You know what my definition of fear in the book, in the new book, Flip the Switch, is? Fear is a positive emotion that is absolutely necessary to activate your prey drive so that you can do something big in the world. How many of you are motivated when you fear going broke? Raise your hand. How many of you are motivated when you fear losing everything you've worked your whole life for? Raise your hand. How many of you are motivated when there's some healthy fear in your life? Fear is not a negative. Fear is a positive thing that causes you to take freakish levels of success. In March of last year, I feared my whole business, everything I've done my whole life, going straight down the drains. I couldn't speak. All the corporate agreements I had were going down the drains. I'm sitting there going, what are we going to do? What are we going to do, man? I can't go on the road, which is one of the number one ways I market my business. I am scared to death. I'm watching our sales numbers do this right here. One of my core principles is when I'm scared, I multiply my actions. I said, man, I'm going to do a video every day. I'm going to do one every night. I'm going to go harder on Instagram. I'm going to engage with my current clients. And I did free events all day long for companies. I said, any company in the world that wants training, that wants to keep their people motivated, I'll do it for free. And guess what? I was doing 8, 9, 10 Zooms a day. I couldn't see at night when I went home. But guess what? Many of those companies that I did for free signed me on to long-term coaching contracts. Because when in doubt, what do? Take an action. Fear is your friend. Number two motivator or activator prey drive is competition. Some of you don't have a fight to be in right now. You don't have a game to play. You don't have a trophy to win. David Goggins talks about the trophy's not on your trophy case. Where's it at? The trophy's in your mind, man. My mom worked at nursing homes her whole life where she took care of elderly people. And I asked her at the end of people's life, Mom, why do people die? She said, there's three reasons, son. Number one, they run out of money. When you run out of money, you run out of good care. There's one nurse for every 23 patients in a nursing home. That's why you need a lot of money when you get older, folks. Okay? Number two, she said they run out of love. Nobody comes to see them. All they have is their friends there at the nursing home and the nurses. They don't have any love, she said, but the real reason that people pass away is they run out of purpose. They don't have something to get up and push toward. They don't have something to fight for. Joe Paterno, 82 years old, coaching Penn State, walked 25 miles a day, ran Gasser with his lineman. They fired him. He was dead within 6 months because he ran out of purpose. I intentionally create competition. Me coming here trying to win you over in 45 minutes is a competition to me because you're skeptical. You don't know who Coach Bird is. Why is Coach Bird speaking? Coach Bird's not as big as some of these other people. That's how I felt when I spoke at 10X too. Me, Milet, Cardone, Damon John, I'm the underdog. I'm like, that's a great place to be, man, because these people don't know who I am, but they damn sure about to find out. Right or wrong? I like being underdog, man. I like being underdog. Because they don't, there's no expectation of an underdog. You come in and shock people. They're like, man, where'd this little bald-headed dude come from? This little pit bull. Here's my point, folks. Business is sport to me. Tillman Fertitta talks about business as sport. That's all it is, man. That's why you got to set freakish targets and you got to wake up every day and you got to push. It's a game. There's a trophy, but it's not on a trophy case. Where's the trophy case? It's in your mind. Third activator, prey drive, is exposure. First time I met Brad Lee, I met him in Mexico at Riviera Maya at Grant Cardone conference. Cardone had asked me to come down and speak at the very first 10X in Riviera Maya. There were 75 people there. And Brad Lee was there, Melissa Lee was there, and Grant Cardone was there, and Elena Cardone was there, and Matt Manero was there, and his wife. And I took my girlfriend at the time, who became my wife, and she didn't get it. Here's what she said. Oh, yeah, we're going to Mexico, man. I'm going to sit out, drink margaritas. Why you go to that conference? I said, no, sweetheart. You're going to that conference with me. And you're going to sit in there, and you're going to be around power couples. And I want you to watch how Brad and Melissa Lee interact with each other. And I want you to watch how Cardone and Elena interact with each other. And Matt Manero and his wife interact with each other. And my wife, a little country girl from West Tennessee, watched these power couples. And on day three of that conference, she said, I get it. I get it, which is why it's so powerful, you two doing things together. I get it. You know how many people I coach that they say, I want to grow, but can't get my spouse on board? I want to do big things, but I go home and they erode my confidence. Man, I got big dreams, but my spouse don't believe in me. Exposure is when you see something that it opens your mind to bigger possibilities. Everybody see that?
Yes.
Now my wife is now writing her own books. Now she's hosting her own conferences. And by the way, she did drugs every day from 21 to 24 years old. She had no direction, no purpose, no goals, no dreams, no hopes. She was selling cell phones for Verizon. They sent her to one of my workshops. She paid $50. She sat in the back. She'd never read a self-help book in her life. I kind of knew her, but I didn't really know her. At the end of that workshop, after 2 hours with me, she was writing notes. She came direct up to me. She said, can I see you? Can I meet with you? And she was real pretty. And I'm like, yes, you can. We can meet right now. She said, no, I don't want to meet right now. She said, but I got something, and I don't even know what I've got. I got potential. I got a dream. I got hopes. I got goals. And she says, you have activated something inside of me that is dead. What I activated was her prey drive. Everybody see that? 30 years old. My mother's 60 years old. She's coming to my workshops now, and she does pay the full amount, by the way. And I said, Mama, you're 60 years old. You're taking care of me. You're taking care of my brother. You're taking care of people in nursing homes your whole life. Girl, go chase your dreams. It's time for you to go do what you're supposed to do in the world. I'm trying to activate my own mother's prey drive. Everybody hear that? Exposure. My mom don't read self-help books. Now she is. 60 years old. Exposure is an activator of prey drive. I got two more and I'm done. Environment is an activator of prey drive. Environment is an activator of prey drive. I've been in a lot of cool places, a lot of cool offices in my lifetime. None of them are cooler than Bradley's office. Would you agree?
Yeah.
I asked him one day, dude, what's up with the rhinos? Why is there all these rhinos everywhere? You know what he said? Have you ever tried to stop one? I thought, man, that's cool. How many of you believe you can create an environment where people thrive in? See, when I was a basketball coach, that's the whole purpose, man. I'm trying to create an environment where you can thrive in. You can be your best. I like energy. I like lights. I like music. I like anything that will force you to play up. I did a big country music concert at my lodge. I got this beautiful lodge in Tennessee. And I had a big country music concert a few weeks there. And I had an artist that I thought had kind of gone dead. I had an up-and-coming artist named Lewis Bryce, which is Lee Bryce's brother, and I had another artist that I've known for years, but man, he lost his mojo. And my wife said, why don't we book him to play because he's one of our friends, and I said, man, I'm not booking him. He don't have any confidence. He's not playing at a high level. I'm not putting him in front of these people. I'm not doing it. And I finally gave in. I said, you know what? I'm going to give this dude a shot. And the first artist came in that's going to be a major star, and man, he tore the whole place down. Energy, charisma, mojo, confidence. Then I put my guy on after him. Guess what he was forced to do? That's the best I've seen him in 10 years. He sang like I've never seen him sing before. He played with passion like I hadn't seen in 10 years because environment forced him to play up versus play down. Some of you create environments where people play at low levels versus high levels, folks. I have high expectation. You want high expectation or no expectation? You want high expectation. Number five and final activator prey drive is embarrassment. Embarrassment. I do not embarrass people when I coach them. I coach people in all forms. We coach people everything from one-to-one to groups to companies to everything. I do not use embarrassment. I do not embarrass adults. But here's what I will ask you, a hard question. Help me to understand why you're telling me one thing and doing another. Help me to understand why you're doing $1 million a year when you ought to be doing $20 million a year. Help me to understand why you have all this potential but you're not doing anything with it. Help me to understand why I'm trying to get you from A to B but I can't get you to stay focused. Help me to understand. When I see people doing much more than I'm doing, that I go, man, I'm embarrassed. I'm embarrassed. Because I have so much more in me than what I'm showing. They're not more talented than you are. They don't have more skill than you do. Or maybe they do have more skill. Or maybe they just have more confidence than you do. But you got to get to the point where you wake up every day, man, and you want to get in the arena and you say, man, I'm embarrassed by the way I'm performing. Brad's right. I shouldn't have been doing $250,000 a month. I should have been doing $2.5 million a month. Every time he calls me and says, what's wrong with you? And he does call me about once a quarter and ask me that question. I don't get offended. I get off that phone and I go, this dude's right, man. All he's trying to do is get me to another level. That's all this dude's trying to do. Some of you get offended when somebody tries to say that to you. You should say, you know what? You're right. I'm embarrassed, man. I'm embarrassed by the level I'm playing at versus the level I'm capable of playing at. Embarrassment is an activator, a prey drive. I'll close with this story. Some of you are going to come to this real conference and you're going to say that'll work for him, but, and I look forward to seeing all of these people. I've never seen Rob Luna, Rob back there, but I've heard a lot about Rob from multiple people. I've watched his videos. I want to learn. I'm here. I have no arrogance about me whatsoever. I'm totally humble about where I am in the world and what I'm trying to get to. Humble, hungry, and coachable. I was playing tennis with my 8-year-old daughter in Seaside, Florida, where we have a house. And I would hit her the ball, and she would hit it over there and hit it down there, and she started crying, and she'd break down, and she said, I can't do it, Daddy. I just can't do it, and I can't do it. I'm only 7 years old, and I can't do it. And I said, time out, girl. Let's step over here for just a minute. We stepped over there, and I said, look, you can say I'm trying to do it. You can say I'm working on doing it. You can say, Daddy, I'm going to do it. But I don't ever want to hear you say again, Daddy, I can't do it. We went right back out after just a little coaching session, and I hit it to her, and she hit it over there. You know what? She said, Daddy, I'm trying to do it. Next ball, I hit her. Daddy, I'm going to do it. Right? And she kept getting better. She didn't lose that language again, because some of you say, yeah, it will work for Brad Lee, but he's better looking than I am. It would work for him, but it won't work for me. It'll work for them, but it won't work for me. So we go home after our vacation, and my daughter says to me, she's like, hey, Dad, I want you to do a cartwheel. Because she's a gymnast, and I'm sitting there looking at her, I'm like, yeah, sweetheart, but I'm 43 years old. I'm 44 years old, and I just can't do it. And my 7-year-old daughter looked at me and said, come here. Sit down. And I sit down, and I said, yeah. She said, I don't ever want to hear those words come out of your mouth again. You can say, I'm trying to do it. You can say, I'm getting better at it. You can say, I'm going to do it. But I don't ever want to hear you say, I can't do it. Isn't that good? My 7-year-old daughter teaching me a lesson, folks. Folks, I want to thank you for having me today. I'm Coach Michael Burt. Everybody needs to activate that play drive. Let's go.
Hey, don't go nowhere, Coach. Don't go nowhere, Coach. All right, you know everybody and their dog is going to have some questions. And just again, earlier what I was talking about. See, if I spoke like him, I'd be a trillionaire, huh? Give it up one more time. I always say, dude, shit, if I could get my content down like that, I got shit to say. Like, dude, amazing, huh? Hey, now, earlier I was talking about training. You heard me.
Yes.
Now, again, if you guys wanted the good content part, he's got a VT system. Approach him or somebody while you're here. He's going to be here for dinner and everything.
Yep.
Pick his brain. If you'd want Coach 24/7 teaching your people this type of shit on a regular basis, who would want that? Mm. Now, watch this. What if you said, hey, dude, I got some shit for you. Coach Burt's going to walk you through some stuff. Go through that. And then all of a sudden, 2 weeks later, you see that they just didn't do it. What's that indication of? Huh? They're not engaged. What does an unengaged employee cost a company?
A lot of money. Listen, on average, most companies are wasted 3 to 4 hours a day. Most people inside companies are wasted 3 to 4 hours a day on low-value activity. But I want to say something. All confusion is created by the leader. If the leader allows people not to be trained, how many of you believe trained people always outperform untrained people? Raise your hand. Okay. Do you think I rolled in as a basketball coach and said, hey, you know, it's okay if we don't practice today? Or do you think I said we're going to practice every day, man? And we're going to do the same thing over and over and over. All confusion is created by the leader. If your people are lazy, it ain't their fault, it's your fault. Because you allow them to be lazy. You think you can be lazy and work with me every day? No, because I don't allow people to be lazy. We don't whine, we don't complain, we don't make excuses. Okay, and I tell people I'm looking for Navy SEALs, not baby SEALs. Okay, so if I actually try to discourage people from working for me. They say, I want to work with you, and I'm like, no, you don't. Trust me. And I make them tell me why they want to work. Then I send them my top 25 beliefs. These are 25 things I believe. I believe in coming in early and staying late. I believe when a man asks you to go 1 mile, you go 2. I believe in always over-delivering in what we promise. Now, if you have a problem with any of those 25 beliefs, let's not even go to round 2.
And that's how it's done. And by the way, like, that's how you take last place teams, make them first. That's how you build culture and organizational love, the fam at work. It's unbelievable. Hey, who's got questions? No fucking questions? Go ahead.
What if you're kind of afraid to take that next level?
Good question.
What if you're afraid to take that next level and to be just absolute great because of the responsibility and expectation that comes with that?
You know, I'm writing about this right now in the book because I'm writing these chapters on these activators. And one of the activators is fear. So I was going through, what are people afraid of? Afraid of embarrassment, afraid of rejection, afraid of failure. And I have a hard time with I'm afraid of success. But really, what you're really saying is exactly what you just said. With more success comes more responsibility, more burden, right? It feels like a burden when I'm coaching thousands of people around the country. But here's the deal. That's not something to be afraid of. Bezos uses something called a regret minimization factor. He asked himself, if he were at 80 years old, would he regret if he didn't do this? Right? So you got to ask yourself, your desire to help people has got to become greater than your desire to be comfortable. And when that desire overrides the other desire, then it don't matter about how successful you want to be. You're successful because of your impact. You want to help more people. All the money and everything else will come when you help more people. So that's a deep psychological thing that you can deal with, but that's not one you need to be afraid of. Trust me.
Good Boom. Question.
Who was the older country singer that played at your party? And did that change his direction? Did he make any kind of comeback after he sang at your party?
Well, that dude has been playing in Nashville for 10 or 12 years in the honky tonks on Broadway. I've watched him, and I partnered with, I've had Randy Houser, I've had Lewis Bryce, you know, had some people that are big time people and up and coming people. And there's nothing like watching a star on their way up, right? So I hope that night, what I've told my wife is that night reactivated that dude's prey drive. So it'll be interesting to see what happens to him over the next few years.
Hi, Coach. My name's Robert.
Hello.
We've got a company with about 120 staff. We have an in-house training group that we just started up. We have a director who comes from a big bootsu company, and we have three support staff. What should be their two, three main core values, focuses with the rest of the company?
Yeah, the question is, what should be our training? Here's the deal. Training, to Brad's core values, training's not something we did, it's something we do. I train people to a system. What I mean by a system is if I'm training salespeople, I have a system. How do we activate their prey drive? How do we explain our service? How do we generate leads? How do we follow up on those leads? How do we extract referrals? And how do we become people of interest? We call that the monster growth system. That's the system I have with Brad. Now, here's the deal. Lots of people train on random things. The average cat cannot retain what they hear unless it is taught to them over and over and over and over and over and over. So I would put the system in place and train people to the system. Hold people accountable to the system. You're not holding them accountable to their attitude. You're holding them accountable to, do you know how to explain our service? Do you know how to follow up appropriately? So that's what I would coach them to. Yep.
One more. Neil. Okay, two more.
Hey, Coach Burke. So if you have employees that are unengaged, not responding to coaching and stuff like this, what's the best way to fire somebody so we don't get the bad reviews on Glassdoor?
Yeah, you need to tell them you're freeing them up to chase their real passion. We don't fire people. Here's the deal. I set standards, expectations. People don't hit those expectations. They typically fire themselves. People come to me and say, I just can't go at this pace. I don't want to go at this pace. I don't want to have this expectation on me. So I really set the stage up front for this is going to be the hardest work you've ever done, but it's going to be the best thing you've ever done. I'm looking for Navy SEALs, not baby SEALs. If you ask Rob O'Neill what he did on the way over to shoot Bin Laden, you said, well, you're getting excited. Were you getting all hyped up? Were you getting all jacked up? Here's what they did. He said some of them were asleep. Some of them were listening to their headphones. And then he looked at me and he said, Coach, because that's just what we do, man. We've been trained to go get bad people. That night just happened to be Bin Laden. I tell my people, man, I'm not here to babysit you. I'm here to help you get to a high degree of personal success in your life. I'm giving you the products, the services, the coaching for you to make as much money as you want to make with me behind you, right? Now, if you don't want that, you need to go to the complacency factory, not the greatness factory.
Hello.
There's a lot of people at the complacency factory.
Thank you, Coach. My name's Angela. We're from Dubai. In our business, we have lots of different departments. So we have sales, we have digital, we have hospitality company. And one of the struggles that we have is that we don't have consistency because each department is run by different individuals. So when you look at things like the Monster Growth system that you use, is this something that your staff are using on an hourly basis? Is it a daily basis? Or is it just consistently throughout their working day?
It's typically they have to watch X number of segments every day before they get to work. In my system, we actually have operational coaching, management coaching, sales coaching. So a company would purchase my system, and the operations people would watch the operational stuff, the managers would watch the management, the salespeople watch the salespeople. The people who have the most success do it every day and talk about it every day. So they may watch it on the screen together, and then there's an accountability loop where they talk about it. And I know this works because when I go train a company in person and they've been on my VT system for 30 days, it's like they've been with me for a year. When I go to a company that's not on the VT system, we spend the whole first 3 months trying to get them going. So what's the power of being trained? What if I live with you every day? What if I was in your grill every day, pushing you every day? That's the power of a VT system. Is if you hold people accountable to it and they use it, I'm there every day. And that's really the power of this system.